Ooh. Hey everybody, Chris of Coalition Gaming here. We're back with a giveaway rig that we built on stream. Was it last week or so? Anyways, we still have the build video coming for you guys, but as it stands now, let's go ahead and show you the benchmarks of how it came out. As you can see, this is the final product. Honestly, my assessment of where this computer went in terms of performance was as good as I expected. Honestly, maybe if not a little better. It's a 6-core, 12-thread Xeon W3680, 8 GB of RAM on an EVGA X58 motherboard. So it's pretty solid specs, albeit a bit on the older side, sure. But yeah, IPC jumps haven't been that crazy. So it's still a relevant processor, especially if you overclock it. Now, stock performance at 3.5 gigahertz all core did fantastic, but turbo performance, no turbo, but meaning rather overclocking performance, I got it to 4.2 gigahertz. I threw just a quick and dirty overclock on it to get it to 4.2 at 1.35 volt, and it never really broke 60-ish, maybe mid 60s. Under load with this Hyper 212 on it, not the greatest of coolers, but a pretty good, better than stock cooler. So we did get a mild overclock, and at 4.2 is, from my understanding, pretty easy to get a solid stable overclock, pretty safe overclock. And beyond that, it starts getting a little more difficult, having to add more voltage. This cooler can't really handle that much more voltage, so unless you go water, even AIO. But as it stands, 4.2 across all 6 cores also did pretty good. So the 1060 3 GB did meet a limitation. And well, obviously that's 3 GB of VRAM. And the only game that we tested, and I didn't test the whole bunch, I'm just wanting to get a quick one out there for you guys, was PlayerUnknown's Battlegrounds. That game on high preset took up just about 3 GB of VRAM. So as long as it stayed under 3 GB of VRAM use, it actually did really great. And then when it would ping a little bit over 3 GB, and it never really went too much higher than 3 GB, but it did go over occasionally, the FPS would start to drop a little bit. So a mix of settings for 1060 3 GB that keep it well under 3 GB at any moment would be the best. But as it stood on 1080p, 1680 by 1050 high settings preset, it did really well. One more thing about the resolution is I don't have a 1080p test monitor. I have a 1680 by 1050. It's an old one that I had, which is something like less than 400 pixels difference from 1080p. It's very close to 1080p. So in my opinion, that the performance at 1680 by 1050 should be roughly identical to 1080p performance. Anyways, let's get into the charts. So starting off with Cinebench, we're looking at a stock CPU single core score of 105. We have a overclock score at 4.2 gigahertz of 125. That's a 20 point increase. It's a nice little increase, but where the real story is here is the CPU multi-core score of 790 stock and 908 overclocked. 908 on the CPU multi-core score puts it within modern i7 performance range, maybe not the 6-core 8700Ks, but it definitely puts it in there with like a Haswell, maybe even Skylake, and overclocked Sandy Bridge and Ivy Bridge. So that's kind of neat. The OpenGL score stock was 81.01, and the overclock score was 91.84. That's a little bit over a 10 FPS increase there, which is really nice because all that was a quick and dirty CPU overclock. Onto Battlefield 1, we used the high preset with HDR off, 5% motion blur at 1680 by 1050 resolution as previously discussed. We had a 0.1% low stock of 12 FPS, overclocked of 13.6 FPS. So the 0.1% low improved. And I'm not sure about the actual trustworthiness of the 0.1% lows in terms of, like, you know, certain drops affecting it too much and how it was being recorded via MSI Afterburner RTSS. I haven't really done this kind of benchmarking before, so please bear with me. And I hope the numbers are good for you guys. Anyways, the 1% low reported as 50 stock, 50 FPS, and 58.1 overclocked. So 58.1 overclocked, that's a nice little increase over 50. We had a max FPS stock of 106.9, and overclocked, the max FPS was 129.6. That is over a 20 FPS increase max, which is kind of nice. The average FPS that was 98.5 overclocked, 86.8, I believe, stock. So that was over a 10 FPS increase average. Really nice. The minimum FPS we saw was 60.5 stock and 71 at with the CPU overclock. So this just goes to show you that Battlefield 1 does like higher CPU performance, and it really helps unlock the performance of the GTX 1060 3GB. On to the next slide, we have Overwatch using the high preset, and again 1680 by 1050. We have a 0.1% low of 10.8 stock and 18 overclocked, 18 FPS. All these are FPS numbers. So the that's a nice little increase, just about 8 FPS at the 0.1%. 1% low we have at 59.6 and stock, and massive increase went with the overclock at 119.5. So smoothness really improves in Overwatch with the good CPU overclock. Max FPS went from 227.3 stock to 266.6 overclocked. So yep, definitely Overwatch likes a good CPU overclock, especially if it's holding back your GPU. Average FPS didn't change all that much. We went from 178.1 stock to 178.7 overclocked. But that number doesn't tell the whole story, considering that the 1% low and the 0.1% low both improved, especially the 1% low improving over 100 FPS. So I'm not sure if that's an issue with how I measured it, or simply the game just ran that much smoother with the CPU overclock. But yeah, the minimum FPS we saw was 59.9 stock and 107.4 overclocked. So this game really, really benefited with the CPU overclock, despite the average FPS numbers not particularly demonstrating that. On to the next slide, we have the ever popular PUBG. So we went to the high preset, X1680 by 1050. And as previously mentioned, the high preset really put a strain on the VRAM limit of the 1060 3GB card. So let's just go right into the numbers anyways. So the 0.1% low stock was 0.1. It was pretty much as low as you get. The game can be very, I guess you'd say, jumpy, hiccupy, stuttery under bad conditions. It's gotten a lot better since release, and it's gotten a lot better again since the 1.0 official release. So anyways, the overclocked 0.1% low was 7.7. So, I mean, that's a pretty significant increase in terms of percentages if you look at it there. But the whole point of the thing is, even when it drops low with an overclock, it's still trying to hold on to something a little higher than usual. And 7.7 is always better than 0.1. So the 1% low was 16.3 stock and 35 overclocked. So the 1% low represents a good smoothness even when it drops, because anything over 30 is at least fairly smooth. It's not ideal, but it's fairly smooth. 16.3, you're gonna really notice that. Max FPS we saw was 123.3 with 127 overclocked. And this is on the new map, by the way. So two runs, full matches on the new map. Tried to do the same thing on both, keep it sort of even. Average FPS stock was 87 FPS and overclock was 92.5. So a nice little increase there, going from 87 to 92.5, definitely can respect that. Minimum FPS we saw, again, represented above though, was 0.1, and the minimum FPS with the overclock was 11.9. Now, minimum FPS is a lot easier of a throwout number for when you have 0.1% low and 1% low there, but I'd like to include it anyways, just for informational sake. So that's it. Performance is definitely going to be great with this. As you can see, numbers really show how strong of a system even first gen era Xeons and i7s and stuff are. and definitely a really interesting route. Now, it being 6 cores and 12 threads, its multi-threading capability in workstation type stuff or production type stuff like Adobe Premiere or something that utilizes more cores like streaming, that still has power to go to do all that. So as an all-in-one system, I believe this would be a good entry point into single PC gaming and streaming because it has the horsepower for it. The CPU multi-core score may or may not really be representative of how much it can actually handle because it has the additional cores and threads versus a modern i7, well, a more newer i7, rather. But yeah, so definitely a very capable system even now. And it's really great that computer hardware has become so powerful that you can get something that came out in 2011 in terms of hardware, and it still hangs in there with some of the best stuff out today. So as a 1080p machine and down, it's definitely a viable system, and can't wait to get this shipped, I guess all packaged up and stuff and shipped off to the winner. And if you're watching this thing, we're really jealous with how it all came out, the way that the lights look and the fans provided by Cooler Master and the way it looks in this case with the glass. Man, it's one of the nicest looking case builds that we've done. So we got a few more things to tidy up with it though. We got some wire management we want to do. We're going to fix the sleeve cable a little bit so it can be adjusted to be a little nicer. Maybe go over the wiring behind the panel a little bit because, I mean, you guys know how behind panel wiring ends up looking when you start to get in a hurry. The build for this took something like five and a half hours. We were streaming, we were troubleshooting as we were streaming, and we were interacting with our viewers. So if you want to get a look at that, we'll go ahead and link that video in the description below. Anyways, I hope you guys like this video. This is Chris with Coalition Gaming. And if you like this video, again, click that thumbs up button, click that like button, subscribe. We got more coming. Hit the little bell on it to get notifications for when we upload new videos. And we'll see. Then you get